This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Good morning, Tusculum family. I hope you're all well and safe. I know this week has been a really difficult week. It's been challenging as we've witnessed some of the things that we've witnessed and we've heard some of the things that we've heard. And this morning, I just want to start off by reading a verse. And as I read this verse, I want you to think about God saying this to us right now. God speaking to you right now through His Word. It's 2 Chronicles 7:14. I came across this verse this week. And read along with me if you'd like, but listen as I read. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear them from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. And right now, we need to be the church more now than ever. Not just a church, but we need to be the church. And one of the responsibilities we have to one another in the church is spurring one another on constantly towards becoming more and more Christ-like every day. And we have to develop these godly life skills and make sure that we're implementing them in our lives and our daily walk, again on a weekly basis to make sure that we're living up to what we are supposed to be doing. And this is our responsibility to help grow one another and to help mature in our faith and in our walk. And this morning, because that's how we're going to stand apart from the world. And this morning, Steve's going to really be kind of talking us through a lot of these kind of life skills and kind of challenging ourselves to make sure we're doing what we need to be doing. So thank you so much this morning for joining us. And at this time, let's go ahead and just give our all to the Lord. Let's worship.
A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of His love, and covers me there with His hand, and covers me there with His hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord, He taketh my burden. I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of His love and covers me there with His hand and covers me there. Blessings each moment He crowns, and filled with His fullness divine. I sing in my rapture, O glory to God, for such a Redeemer as mine. He hideth my soul in the cleft of a rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hides my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. When clothed in his brightness, transported, I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hides my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hides my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand.
Nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee, even though it be a cross that raiseth me, still all my song shall be nearer, my God, to thee, nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. Though like a wanderer the sun gone down, darkness be over me, my rest a stone, yet in my dreams I be nearer, my God, to thee, nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to
Hey everybody, I hope you're doing well on this Sunday, June the 7th. In a few minutes, you will be listening to a sermon that I pre-recorded about 3 weeks ago, which was about 2 weeks before the events that transpired in the death of George Floyd on May the 25th. So in that pre-recorded sermon, I don't make any references to that or the racial tension that's going on in our world today. I think you can use that sermon and make many applications from it due to the content of it, that's helpful in the world today to understand it better. So I hope you'll do that when you listen to that lesson. But again, it was pre-recorded, but I wanted to make a few comments before you listen to that sermon, and speak into and speak God's word into the current crisis that we see unfolding in the world today as it relates to race and racism. And there's a word that has emerged on the cultural scene today, a word that maybe you've never heard, but your kids and your grandkids have, I promise you that, and the word is woke. And the word woke, it used to mean just being with it, being in the know, and having your eyes wide open to what's going on around you and what's going on in the world. You're not asleep at the wheel. You know what's going on. And of late, the word woke has taken on a more focused meaning, specifically being awakened to matters of social injustice and particularly racism, a plague that has been on this continent for around 400 years now. And I don't have to tell you that our country and our world is involved in a deeply racial crisis. The world literally is changing right in front of our eyes. And you would have to be hiding under a rock over the past week or so to not know what's going on in this world. You may not like it, but one thing you cannot do, and that is ignore it. It came to a head again on May the 25th when George Floyd lost his life in the hands of police officers in Minneapolis. And it was an event that sent shockwaves around the world, unlike anything I have ever seen in my lifetime, and maybe anything you've ever seen in your lifetime. Enormous change is in the air. Enormous tension is in the air. And I just want to, before you listen to my sermon that I have pre-recorded for you, I want to speak God's word a little bit, just a little bit, into this current situation as it relates to race. The Bible starts out the race conversation at the dawn of man. At the very beginning, God shows his hand as to how he is going to create mankind. Genesis 1, 26 and 27, just two verses here in the first chapter of the Bible, the book of origins, Genesis. Then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created man. Not a race of man, just a man. Just a man from whom we all have our common ancestry, every single one of us. In his image, in the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them, period. That's how it all got started. There was one race. There wasn't a kind of people. There weren't many races. There was one race, and it was the human race, and it was God's design for humanity from the very beginning. Now, man has gone and tampered with all of that and polluted all of that, but that's not God's fault. Now, two things you notice in these verses. Number one, we're all created by God in his image. And this means that God made us with a certain amount of himself in us. He made us to be eternal beings. We have a soul, and we are to be in perfect relationship with God and in perfect unity and relationship with one another as the human race. And then God created diversity. He created distinction. He created variety within the human race. It says he created us male and female. Also, each of us are individually unique, even beyond sexuality. Every human being who has ever been born is one of a kind. No one has your fingerprint. No one has your same retina display. And no one has everything you have exactly the way you have it. You have a skin color. You might be black, you might be white, you might be red, yellow, or brown. But God created mankind, put things in order so that that all could evolve over time and that there would be extreme diversity, enormous, beautiful diversity in mankind. The children's song that many of us grew up on is so true. Jesus loves the little children of the world, all the little children of the world, red and yellow, black and white. They are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. And this is how the Bible puts it in Acts chapter 17 and verse 26. From one man, this common ancestor, he made every nation of men that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the times set for them and the exact places where they should live. And Paul says in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 28, there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. We are equal in the eyes of God, regardless of all the unique factors involved, especially regardless of our skin color, which was all simply a part of God's design for the human race. If you hate or mistreat a person simply because they have a different skin color than you, then you hate God's design and you are in rebellion against God. God created it the way he wanted to create it, and who are we to try to tamper with God's perfect design of mankind, the human race? This is how the Apostle Peter put it in the New Testament when the message of Jesus was breaking down cultural, geographic, and ethnic barriers. Acts 10, verse 34, God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation. And if God accepts men from every nation and in accordance with their own unique design, including skin color especially, then we should accept men from every nation as well. And we should even celebrate it. Celebrate that we're all created in God's image. We have his likeness in us. We have eternal souls. Like one day we're going to be together, those who choose to be together in heaven, we're going to be there together, and we should celebrate the design of God and not try to destroy it. And Acts 10:34, God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation. And that's how it all got started. One race, the human race, diversity, made in the image of God. Therefore, racism in every form and amongst any people is evil. Just plain and simple, it is evil. So will the church say amen to that? It better, because this is God's word as it relates to race. And we all need to appreciate God's unique design of all humankind, humanity, the one race he created, from which comes all the variety. We should celebrate that, and we should praise God for it, and not fight, and kill, and destroy each other because of our social conditioning of the world. We are to be transformed. We're not to be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds, Paul says in Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. I'm going to leave you with this before you listen to the second sermon, the one I recorded 3 weeks ago. I want to read a letter that my son Jacob, who is the president of his social club, his fraternity at Lipscomb University, he wrote this letter just a day or two after the events that transpired in on May the 25th when, again, George Floyd lost his life in the hands of the Minneapolis police officers. Jacob felt like he needed to say something to his club. His club has black, white, brown, and I guess everything in between. And he wanted to speak into the situation that's going on. Leaders do that. Leaders stand up and say, here is what I'd like to say as it relates to what's going on, especially when it's going on and affecting the lives of every man, woman, and child in the world. And he said this, he wrote this letter. Gentlemen, with everything that is happening in cities all across the country and media presence being at an all-time high, I wanted to take a moment and speak to the history that we are witnessing and what is unfolding right in front of us. Now, by no means do I think I have all the answers, but one thing that I do know is that it is immensely important to be open to tough conversations and be willing to see the perspectives of the communities most affected by this movement, and above all else, come from a place of love rather than a position of hate and spite. I urge you all to be very conscious of the language you use moving forward, being aware and knowledgeable of the movement that is taking place as we speak. And above all, and anything else, be the men of God that you are called to be. It is our duty to be willing to filter through the ulterior motives of some that have taken away from the meaning behind what is a very important and monumental movement. As president of this club, I am letting all of you know now that not a single one of you can say that what is going on in regards to the Black movement matters, in regards to the Black Lives Matter movement, does not affect you. You can't say it doesn't affect you. We have members, brothers of this club, who are of color and have faced oppression in their lives that a majority of us cannot relate to, nor will we ever be able to understand completely. This is not something that is going to be swept under the rug, but rather will be projected publicly for everyone around the world to see. And I would like, or I would hate, for any of us to not be educated or sympathetic enough to be able to fight for and listen to what people you love believe in and help them in their efforts to make change happen. Love you, boys. Needless to say, I'm very proud of Jacob. And I only wish that I, as his father, could write so well and with such passion. Again, the sermon that you are about to hear was pre-recorded 3 weeks ago, and I think that you can easily make some applications to the current situation we find ourselves in, times we find ourselves living in today. I think you'll find that to be easy to do. And God bless you as you do your part in being a godly influence, standing up for godly things, godly principles, as our world is watching to see how all of us will handle it. And we as the church, we need to understand some basic biblical principles when we go into all the world and try to share our faith in the risen Savior with a lost and dying world. God bless you. Enjoy the sermon. Okay, so church, what I want to do today is a little bit different. And some of you have been in my Bible classes when I presented this particular material, but a lot of you have not been in there, so I wanted to share it with everybody. For several years now, going all the way back into the early 2000s, I have presented a workshop, a listening workshop, different congregations around the country, in fact. And it's called Lab One, and there's several pieces to it, and I want to share one piece of that with you today. As the church, we're told to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And when we do that, when we go into all the world, we're going to meet all kinds of people from all kinds of backgrounds, very diverse backgrounds. And so we need to understand a lot of things that maybe we take for granted when we're trying to share the gospel with people. What I want to show you today, I call it the life box. Everybody has a certain size life box. And inside that box contains all of your, what I call your excellence, all of your coping skills, all of the things you draw from, all of the resources you draw from to create a life and to deal with the adversities of life and even the good times in life. So we all have a certain size life box. So I want to share with you on the screen today some things that might help you to understand yourself, and not only yourself, but understand the people that you live with, the people you work around, the people you play sports with, people you live around, and anybody that you try to contact, make contact with in any kind of way, not just in trying to share your faith in them, in Christ with them, but in any situation. But specifically, I'm talking to the church today about things we need to understand as we go into all the world and we preach the gospel, as we evangelize the world. You see on the screen here, I have what's called the life box, and I'll
develop this for you. You see the word anxiety going down the left-hand side of the screen here, and then you see the lifeline. This represents from 0 to 100. That represents from the time of one's birth until the time of one's death. Again, we call this the life box. And so as we go through life, a lot of things happen in life. All of these X's that's coming up on the screen, these X's represent things that happened to you in your life that were hard, things that brought a great deal of anxiety into your life. They say that anxiety is the first human emotion at birth and the last human emotion at death. But all of these X's represent, and we could put literally thousands of them on the screen because so many anxiety-provoking events come into our lives. And so you can see here around 0 to 5, say 5 years old, something happens, whatever that might be. Maybe it's even a crisis situation that comes into a person's life right there. And these red X's represent those hardest things that come into our lives, anxiety that's so difficult to handle that we never get full closure on it. And so, again, I could talk about thousands of stories that each of these X's represent in your life. And I think about this one here, the red X, and let's say around 14 years of age. A lady one time, she was walking out of the church building years ago, and I just touched her on her shoulder, said, "Good to see you," and she jerked her shoulder back, and she said, "I can't stand to come to church because people always want to touch you. They want to touch you. And she kept hitting that shoulder, and she started to cry. And all I did was said, "Good to see you, and I hope you'll come back." And so she got extremely emotional. So I followed her out to the parking lot. I said, "I'm so sorry. Is there something that I did or something that I said?" And she started to cry. And I said, "When you touch your shoulder right there, when you touch your shoulder where I touched you, what comes to mind?" And she started to cry uncontrollably. And she said, "When I was about 14 years old," that's called a rehearsal story. "When I was about 14 years old, I visited my uncle, and there was a man there. I was out playing in the barn, and he came out there, and he drug me into a horse stall, and he sexually molested me. And he told me if I ever told anybody, he would kill me." Now, that's a pretty significant anxiety-provoking event that came into her life. And it was still controlling her to a certain degree, even into her 40s. So that's just an example of one of those red X's and how something can happen so devastating in your life. And all of us have things that are difficult to deal with, anxiety-provoking events. So let's develop this further. What I want to do here is show you a certain person that I know. I want to show you her box, the size of her box. Okay, let's develop this. So let's say this person grew up in a Christian home. Now, if you're a Christian and you've been a Christian for a long time, you may take that for granted that you grew up in a Christian home. If you grew up in a Christian home, you should thank your mama and your daddy that they taught you the ways of the Lord from the time you were maybe even born. And so the next piece in this lady's box that I'm talking about, she has a Christian marriage and a strong family life. Not everybody has a Christian marriage today. In fact, it might be that the majority does not have a Christian marriage today and doesn't have a strong family life. This lady has she's active in a dynamic church family. And, you know, we like to think of Tusculum as a church where, you know, it's a family of believers, and we'd like to think we're dynamic to a certain degree. And she grew up in a dynamic church family, and she's still in a dynamic church family. She has Bible knowledge. Her faith has been developed through the years. Put that in her box. She has a lot of Christian friends that give her support just about every day of her life. She has, throughout her life, when she was younger, she went to church camps. She went to retreats, vacation Bible school, those kinds of things. Put that in her life box. Prayer, ever since she was a little girl, she's learned how to pray. Her parents prayed with her. People who had a godly influence on her life in Bible classes when she was just a child all the way up into the teenage years, all the way up into the adult years. She knows how to pray. She knows what God says about prayer, and it's a powerful thing in her life. Not everybody has that in their life box. Education, she went to school, got a high school diploma, and she went on to college. Not that you've got to go on to college. Some people choose not to, but she has an education that makes her employable. She has a job. She has financial security. She's not rich, but she's content. She has health, herself and her family, and she's never been abused. She's never been abandoned. She's never been neglected. Many positive experiences all through her life, and a lot of very positive role models. She doesn't have any bad habits that are debilitating, alcohol, drugs, gambling, any kind of addictions like that. So you look at this box. This is a pretty big box. Now, as you look at this, understand that not everybody has this size box. Not everybody grew up in a Christian home. Not everybody has a good Christian marriage. Not everybody has a strong family life. Not everybody is active in a church family. Not everybody has Bible knowledge, and their faith has not been developed ever since they were maybe a little girl or a little boy. Christian friends, some people don't have any Christian friends. And all of these things, that's a pretty big box. And all these things in this box represent, as I said earlier, her excellence, her coping skills. She has so many resources, or her box is so large that regardless of the anxiety that comes into her life, she has a lot of tools at her disposal to deal with the adversities of life. But again, not everybody has this size box. Some people don't have the Christian home. Some people don't have the church family. On and on and on. Some people have a very, very small box. And I submit to the church that it is our job as the church to help people, regardless of how large or small their box is, to increase the size of their box. There are people, many people in our society today, all over the world, who have none of these things. None of them. And there are people who show up at our church building from time to time, sometimes who don't even come to the worship services. They just come looking for answers. They'll ask for me as a preacher. And they'll want to talk about their life and the situation they find themselves in. And I'll ask them questions, about all these things. And it's not unusual for people to say, basically, I don't have any of those things in my life. But again, it's the job of the church to get into people's lives if they want us to, if they want us to help, and help them to increase the size of their box. So are you willing to do that as a Christian? Are you willing to help people to develop a Christian home and to have a stronger marriage and a Christian marriage at some point, hopefully, and a strong family life? Are you willing to invest in people to do that? Can you forego some of your own personal pleasures and hobbies and recreational pursuits and making money or whatever? Can you invest in people? See, as the church, if we don't invest in people and help them to increase the size of their box, then we're simply not being what Christ intends for the church to be. So are you willing to help people to have a more active church life? Bring them to Christ, number one. Are you willing to study with people to give them Bible knowledge and help them to develop their faith? And sometimes people come to us who their box is so small, they know almost nothing, sometimes absolutely nothing about the Bible, about God, about church. They wouldn't know how to even walk through the doors without feeling intimidated. And so are we willing to make it easier for them to increase the size of their box? Are you willing to be a friend to someone who maybe their life has fallen apart, whether they're a Christian or not a Christian, but specifically the world out here that we're told to go and try to reach? Are you willing to send their kids to church camp to make sure that they have the money to do that? Retreats, things like that. Are you willing to pray with people and for people? Are you willing to help people with their education? Help them to find a job? Help them if they have health issues? How about positive life experiences? Maybe you could be a positive life experience for someone who has a very small box and give them some positive experiences with a role model, maybe you as a mentor. And it takes investing in people's lives. Maybe they have some bad habits. Maybe they have some addictions. Maybe they struggle with alcohol. Maybe they struggle with pornography. Maybe they struggle with gambling. You name it. How deeply do you love the Lord, and how deeply do you love people enough to use all of the resources you have in your box that God has given to you, and people who love you have invested and have placed in your box? How willing are you to take those, this excellence, these coping skills, your life experiences, and give those to, or bless others with those things? Can you imagine having none of these things? You might take for granted you have all these things, but there are people out here who are hungering and thirsting to have one of these things. Sometimes, though, life can get so hard and enough anxiety can come into a person's life that they pop out of their box. I call it kind of going flaky. Going flaky. Everybody has an edge on their box. That is, there are enough anxiety-provoking events, hard times, that can come into a person's life that they simply feel like they don't have enough coping skills to deal with it. And so every one of us has an edge on our box. And when we get stressed out enough, we can begin to exhibit some flaky behaviors, and we can pop out of our box. Depends on three things: repetition, duration, and intensity. Repetition means how often is a person dealing with some hard, anxiety-provoking event in their life. You know, if you wake up every day and you hate your job, but you have to go to that job, it's repetitious every day. You hate the thoughts of waking up the next day to go to that job. It happens every day. Let's say you and your husband or your wife fight every day. It's repetitious. It happens over and over and over. That's a high level of anxiety. Let's say you're dealing with some physical issue, health problems, and you deal with it every day. There are people who live and they're in pain 24 hours a day, or when they're awake, they're in pain. That's repetitious anxiety, over and over and over again. Then you've got duration. How long has this anxiety been in a person's life? Maybe some extremely hard red X issue that they're dealing with, and they've been dealing with it for a long time. How about the person who, in their marriage, they've been struggling for 5, 10, 15, 20, 30, 40, 50 years in their marriage? Duration. They've been struggling with some health issue for a long, long time. It's not only repetitious, but the duration is lengthy. And then intensity. Intensity. Exactly what is it that is bringing about the anxiety in a person's life? You know, to lose a job is hard. But to be diagnosed with cancer is intense, even more intense. And it depends on what we have in our box as to how we can handle those things. Regardless of what happens in your life, what anxiety comes into your life, if you've got a Christian home and a Christian marriage, a strong family life, parents who love you, if you're a child, and children who love you if you're a parent, and you have a church family that you can rely on to help you in time of need, you have God's word that you know and that you can go to and find a greater level of faith because of it, and you have Christian friends, and you have a prayer life, and you have all these things we're talking about here, then it's easier to go through life with a box that size. But we as the church sometimes, especially those in the church who maybe grew up in church, where from the time you were born, you were brought to the church building. And those people are fewer and fewer and fewer in number every day. It's getting to the point in our post-Christian world, our post-modern world, that more and more people are leaving churches, or they're coming into churches, and they are struggling with things in their life for they have no idea how to handle it, because we've lived in a godless culture to a great degree. God is always present in His people's lives, but people have grown up not having a very big box and relying on what the world throws into their box. They rely on that more than all these other things. So we've got to help people to develop each of these one at a time. And the ultimate goal is to be born again. Everybody needs to be able to experience transformation, to be born again, to feel a part of a church family that their box is getting more and more full every day. Whose responsibility is it to ensure that people's boxes increase in size every day? It's not just the elders' responsibility. It's not just the deacons or the preachers or any other one person or group of people. It's the church working and functioning together to go into all the world and preach the gospel. And in going into all the world and preaching the gospel, we're going to have to get into people's lives. So ultimately, we're all looking for answers to life's difficult questions. Man who's born of woman is few in days and full of troubles. Job 14:1. And Jesus said, in this life, you will have troubles. So I would like to challenge the church, whatever congregation you're a part of, to understand the responsibility that we have as a blessing of what we have experienced in our own lives, the salvation that's offered through Jesus. We become a blessing to others, that we have to take people from where they are and lead them to where they need to be in Christ. Not to where we want them to be, based on our own opinions and all that, but where God wants them to be. So I would like to challenge you, encourage you to help everybody you know, from the people you live with, the people you go to school with, the people you work with, the people you live around, regardless of their situations, regardless of where they came from, to increase, help to increase the size of their box so that they can find hope, can find true meaning in life, and ultimately they can find Christ, salvation of their souls, and that one day when this life is over, there's this big, huge box in heaven that's full of so many blessings, and God wants everybody to enjoy those. And as the church, that's our goal. That's our responsibility. It is our privilege, and it should be our joy. God bless you.
In Christ alone,
Tusculum family, it is just a blessing to be with you this Sunday morning. If you haven't already seen, I'm excited that we're just going to be able to meet in person here in a few weeks back at the church building as a church family. But more importantly, we're just going to take a few seconds now just to reflect on the communion and what it means for us as Christians. Oftentimes, when we think about communion, it is a somber time. We think about the sacrifice that Jesus went through in his death and what it means for us. But while it can be a somber occasion and a somber time, the communion should be a time of joy in that Christ died for us and we have new life in that. And by taking this communion, we remember the fact that we have another chance because we are imperfect. We have fallen short of what God wanted for us. But through Jesus, through being reminded by taking this bread and cup, we know that we can be with God in heaven one day and that we can fully experience the kingdom of God. And I think that's cause for joy. So let's just take a second now and pray. Heavenly Father, thank you just for what the communion means for us, in that it means new life and not death. Thank you just for keeping us safe during this time. God, I pray your blessing and protection over all of us. And God, just be with the elders and the leaders of Tusculum as they continue to prepare the church building for what will be a joyous occasion in late June. Thank you just for your son dying on the cross. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, Tusculum family. I'd like to share a story with you about something that happened about 35 years ago. A friend of mine and I were driving back from Parkersburg, West Virginia to Searcy, Arkansas to go back to Harding. And I had another friend who lived in Memphis, Tennessee at the time. So we decided to arrange where we would meet them for supper, eat supper, and then spend the night with him and his family and his parents, and then drive on to Harding the next day. So we make the long trip, get to Memphis tired, but ready to have a nice visit. So we get out of the car, and my friend from Memphis there, all excited. And then all of a sudden, my friend from Memphis just turns white as a ghost. And I instantly knew something was wrong, but I had no idea of knowing what was wrong. And he said, Mike, I need you to come over here and we need to talk. First thing he says to me, and I'm really curious what's going on. And with much agony in his voice, he says, Mike, my parents won't let your friend stay with them. You're welcome, but he isn't. And I didn't understand why. You see, my friend, his name is Christmas Atim. He's from Cameroon, Africa. He's a black man. I didn't know that I needed to say to my friend, hey, my friend from Cameroon, Africa, my black friend and I are coming down, and would it be all right if we stay with your parents? Unfortunately, at that moment, my friend had to expose the neatly hidden racism of his parents who are Christians. We worked out something to stay with somebody else that night, and that stuck with me. And at that moment, I experienced for the only time really racism, and it was like a drop of racism in a sea of racism that my friends and that so many people have to experience on a daily basis. I realized that I will never fully understand what it's like to live a life where one never knows when, where, or how he or she will be judged by the color of his skin. I can't. But at that moment, I had just a small taste of that. It grieves me, as I'm sure it grieves each of you, to see what is happening in the news, what is happening around our country, There's a few things I am convinced of beyond a shadow of a doubt. Hatred can never bring about healing. Violence will never build a bridge. And judging someone by their external appearance only makes Satan smile. I do know that if my friend Christmas Atib were to show up at Tusculum, someone would open the door for him. Someone would say, "Hi, what's your name?" Someone might even say, "Hey, come sit with us." That's just the kind of people you are. I also know that we are getting ready to open up our services on the 28th. And you're going to hear a lot more about that in the next few weeks. But my prayer is that as we open our doors, we open them wide to the community. And that I can assure you, our community has a lot of diverse language, a lot of diverse color of skin, has tattoos, has battle scars of life, has addictions, has relationship scars. And also I know that God has a love for them, that God's love for them is so powerful that he has their picture on his wall in his living room called heaven. I'd like to close my comments out with a verse from 1 John 3:16-18 as a verse of encouragement. It reads, "By this we know love, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. But whoever has the world's goods and sees his brother in need and closes his heart of compassion against him, how does God's love remain in him? My little children, let us not love in word only or with tongue only, but in deed and truth. May we embody this love that God has for humanity. May our actions reflect our hearts. And be on the lookout for more announcements about the 28th. And when the 28th comes around, invite a friend. And you are loved, and we look forward to seeing each of you all in a few weeks."